Sup, you beautiful bastards. Hope you had a fantastic Wednesday. Welcome back to the Philip DeFranco Show. And a quick little note before we get started. This morning I posted the second of the three morning news test videos that we're uploading on the channel this week. This one diving into the massive story we're seeing out of the United States about the nationwide prison protest. I mentioned this for two reasons. One, to let you know that it exists, so after today's show you can watch that if you haven't yet. And two, also just to say I've been kind of blown away by the immensely positive response to these new videos. Obviously the crappy situation around why we are having to do this in the first place. That is annoying, but you guys have made it just an incredibly positive experience. With that said, with this show, let's just jump into it. The first thing we're gonna talk about today is some is it fake or are people just that stupid news? We have more ridiculous news in the lead up to the massive event that is the Logan Paul KSI fight, but it actually has to do with the undercard, which actually involves Logan and KSI's brothers fighting one another. You have Jake Paul and Deji, massive creators and entertainers in their own right, but they popped up in the news this morning because things got physical. And there are several angles of all of this happening, but you have Deji showing up to Jake Paul's gym, and this happens. And this stands out to me for two reasons. The first being, I don't have a dog in this fight, but there is something that's kind of nice to see anyone calling someone a bitch and then that person gets slapped. But then, two, when I clock out of my caveman high school mindset regarding this fight, didn't we all just watch a video of a crime? One person said something, the other person took it to a physical place. Is that not assault? That is, unless it's fake, although I don't know if anyone would sign up to be slapped and kind of look as the inferior in a fight. But then again, people degrade themselves far, far more for far, far less every day. But ultimately, we'll have to wait to see what happens outside and inside of the ring. And then let's talk about the massive updates around the Azia Argento story we've been covering. And essentially, the TLDR from the past 2 days, if you haven't seen, a report came out that Azia Argento, who was one of the first women to come out and accuse Harvey Weinstein, had herself paid off an accuser, specifically child star Jimmy Bennett, who said that she sexually assaulted him in 2013 when he was 17. He requested millions, ended up with an agreement to receive $380,000. After all of this happens, Argento releases a statement denying the accusations by Bennett. And regarding the payment, she says she didn't actually do it. It was her boyfriend at the time, Anthony Bourdain. But even with her denying this, there were reports that there were text messages where she said that she did actually sleep with Bennett. Also, there were reports of them being topless in bed together. But as of yesterday, there were just reports of them. We did not see them. But today is a new day. TMZ came into the possession of and posted this picture of the two. And TMZ also posted screenshots that appear to be from after the allegations surfaced between Argento and another person. And in those text messages, if they are real, it appears that Argento once again confirms that she did sleep with Bennett. And that, of course, a massive thing of note, because in California, the legal age of consent is 18. In those texts, it appears she writes, "The public knows nothing, only what New York Times wrote, which is one-sided. The shakedown letter, horny kid jumped me. Later writing, I had sex with him, it felt weird. I didn't know he was a minor until the shakedown letter." Adding that she had 80 pages on him by a private investigator that Anthony hired. Later saying, "If I lose my job, I will move to Africa or the Amazon forest. I want to be among the 90% of the world that doesn't give a fuck about this shit, not the conniving sick 10% of the entitled Westerners." Then in a back and forth about age and consent, she points out that it's 15 in France and Italy, adding, "When I was 17, I was with a 33-year-old man for years." There's also a picture shared of a note that is allegedly written by Jimmy on Ritz-Carlton stationery, reading, "Asia, I love you with all my heart. So glad we met again, and I'm so glad you're in my life. Jimmy, smiley face." And following all of this new information, I'm left with just more questions. One, who leaked these text messages and why? If the text messages are authentic, was it meant to expose Argento, or did they realize that there was no denying that this took place, or at the very least that it definitely looks like it took place? So are they giving up that battle that something actually happened and leaking this so that it crafts the narrative that Jimmy Bennett was the aggressor and the person that pursued and then decided to blackmail her? And so with this story, I want to pass the question off to you because I've just seen so many arguments all over the place with this. With all of this new information, taking it all together, what is your takeaway? And also, do you feel like this story is being treated differently by a lot of people based off of the gender of the accused and the accuser? This despite many people that are pushing the Me Too movement saying that it's not a gender issue, it is a power issue. Let me know what you're thinking in those comments down below. But from that, I want to share some stuff I love today, and today in Austin, brought to you by FullSail.edu/Phil. You may not know this, many people from the nation and even past employees of mine have been Full Sail graduates. In fact, Full Sail grads helped engineer Kendrick Lamar's last record, animate Steven Spielberg's latest movie, design the latest Call of Duty game. And at Full Sail, they specialize in entertainment, media, technology, the arts. You can study online or attend their Florida campus, and best of all, they offer accelerated accelerated degree programs. And so if you're interested, you want more information, head on over to fullsail.edu/Phil. And for the first bit of awesome today, sometimes every now and then I throw in a recommendation. Sometimes it's a movie, a game, a TV show. Today's is a movie. And today I just have to heavily recommend Won't You Be My Neighbor. It's a documentary on Fred Rogers, aka Mr. Rogers. If you're in the mood for a healthy cry, I highly recommend it. Then we had a real surgeon performing surgery in Surgeon Simulator. Then we got the honest trailer for Deadpool 2 featuring Deadpool. Matt Stoney gave us the 1620 Pocky Challenge. We got a brand new Overwatch animated short. We had Kevin Hart giving us another episode of Cold as Balls. And if you want to see the full versions of everything I just shared, the secret link of the day, anything at all, links as always are in the description down below. And then let's talk about all of this Michael Cohen, Donald Trump news. Michael Cohen, of course, Donald Trump's former personal lawyer, his self-described fixer. And so there's been a very long buildup to what we've been seeing over the past 24 hours. Back in April, we saw the FBI execute a search warrant on Cohen's office, home, and hotel room in New York City. And those raids were ordered by the U.S. Attorney's Office for the Southern District of New York. This after Special Counsel Robert Mueller, who was investigating Russia's interference in the 2016 election, referred the matter to the Justice Department. And we've learned since that the investigation was related to a number of activities that Cohen was involved in. These activities included underreporting his income to avoid paying taxes on his taxicab business, also for overinflating his income to secure a home equity loan from a bank, but most notably his activities as they relate to President Trump, then candidate Trump, and campaign finance violations. One was secretly paying adult film star Stormy Daniels $130,000 in hush money. That payment caught the eye of investigators largely because it was made less than 2 weeks before the election. And so you have many people saying that makes it an unreported campaign contribution to Trump's campaign because it would help Trump get elected. And we also later learned that that illegal loan that he obtained, he used that to pay off Stormy Daniels. And two, he was helping facilitate a $150,000 payment from the parent company of the National Enquirer to former Playboy playmate Karen McDougal. And here, this was to buy and bury the story of McDougal and Trump's alleged affair, which once again is being seen as an illegal campaign contribution because of the intent to protect Trump and his campaign. And so all of that brings us to yesterday, where Cohen pled guilty to 8 counts relating to the investigation. And according to the plea document, counts 1 through 5 relate to his taxi business and evasion of personal income taxes. Each of those counts carries a maximum prison term of 5 years. Count 6 also relates to his business dealings and is for making a false statement to a financial institution and carries a maximum prison term of 30 years. Count 7 is willfully causing an unlawful corporate contribution and relates to the McDougal payment and carries a maximum prison term of 5 years. And count 8 charges Cohen with making an excessive campaign contribution and is related to the Stormy Daniels payment and carries a maximum prison sentence of 5 years as well. And so for those keeping score at home, that means he was facing up to 65 years in prison. But now, thanks to this plea agreement he's reached with prosecutors, he's looking at 3 to just over 5 years. As far as Cohen right now, he's released on $500,000 bond and his sentencing is set for December 12th. But one of the biggest things about this situation is what Cohen said in court. During the plea hearing, Cohen was asked to explain the crimes that he had committed, as is standard in these types of hearings. And in regards to counts 7 and 8, he said that he was personally directed to violate campaign contribution laws, specifically stating that he did it, quote, in coordination with and at the direction of a candidate for federal office. I and the CEO of a media company, at the request of the candidate, work together to keep an individual with information that would be harmful to the candidate and to the campaign from publicly disclosing this information. So that in relation to McDougal, and then seemingly regarding the Stormy Daniels situation, he said, once again, in coordination with and at the direction of the same candidate, I arranged to make a payment to a second individual with information that would be harmful to the candidate and to the campaign to keep the individual from disclosing the information. And also pointing out, the monies I advanced through my company were later repaid to me by the candidate. And he said all of this under oath, so also if it turns out he is lying, he is facing even more prison time. Now, as far as what does all this mean for Donald Trump, beyond the political fallout and embarrassment for Trump, it's difficult to say if anything tangible will happen to it. While Cohen has implicated Trump in 2 of these crimes, the president has not been charged and may never be. And this could be because it has been a long-standing practice that presidents cannot be indicted while in office, a practice, not a law. Or two, the attorneys for the Southern District of New York don't have enough evidence to indict the president or don't feel that they have the jurisdiction to go after him. That said, there is an interesting portion of the criminal information document. That document says that executives at a company which we know to be the Trump Organization not only reimbursed Cohen for the $130,000 Stormy Daniels payment, but they gave him bonuses worth $420,000 in total. And so that means the Trump Organization itself could be seen as involved in carrying out this crime, and companies can definitely be indicted. And as far as any other information Cohen might have outside of these related charges, his lawyer had some interesting words last night with Rachel Maddow.
Mr. Cohen has knowledge on certain subjects that should be of interest to the special counsel and is more than happy to tell the special counsel all that he knows, not just about the obvious possibility of a conspiracy to collude and corrupt the American democracy system in the 2016 election, which the Trump Tower meeting was all about, but also knowledge about the computer crime of hacking and whether or not Mr. Trump knew ahead of time about that crime and even cheered it on. And we know he publicly cheered it on, but did he also have private information?
And so what Davis is, of course, talking about here is the now prolific June 2016 meeting between Trump campaign officials and individuals with ties to the Russian government and intelligence services. And as far as the hacking, that seems to be in reference to the DNC and John Podesta. But following all of this, the question becomes, well, what was the reaction? Well, we had Omarosa decide that she needed to somehow be connected to this story. She released a video of Cohen getting on Donald Trump's plane. Apparently, this was meant to show how intimately Cohen was involved with the campaign. But once again, it's literally just a video of Michael Cohen getting on a plane. We also had Rudy Giuliani, who is Donald Trump's current lawyer, saying there is no allegation of any wrongdoing against the president and the government's charges against Mr. Cohen. It is clear that, as the prosecutor noted, Mr. Cohen's actions reflect a pattern of lies and dishonesty over a significant period of time. And you had people like Sean Hannity on his show kind of echoing that point, saying Cohen was probably forced by prosecutors to implicate Trump, and questioning how an investigation regarding Russia turned into tax fraud involving both Cohen and Trump's former campaign chairman, Paul Manafort.
But did we need Robert Mueller for all of this? Think about this. How do you go from an investigation into Russia collusion in the 2016 election, and this is what we have? Taxes from years and years ago, bank fraud, medallions, lying to the FBI. Where's the Russia stuff?
But on that note, I would remind Hannity and people that the whole reason we have Bill Clinton and Monica Lewinsky is because people started investigating a land deal. And in addition to all of this, there's been this idea floated around that Donald Trump might pardon Cohen. But you had Lanny Davis, Michael Cohen's lawyer, on NPR, and he said, "I know that Mr. Cohen would never accept a pardon from a man that he considers to be both corrupt and a dangerous person in the Oval Office." And adding that Cohen has flatly authorized me to say under no circumstances would he accept a pardon from Mr. Trump. And then, of course, all of that brings us to Donald Trump's response, going to Twitter today and saying, "If anyone is looking for a good lawyer, I would strongly suggest that you don't retain the services of Michael Cohen." Adding, "Michael Cohen pled guilty to 2 counts of campaign finance violations that are not a crime. President Obama had a big campaign finance violation and it was easily settled." And what I'll say in regards to that last tweet is Donald Trump is right that the 2008 Obama campaign was fined $375,000. It was one of the biggest fines ever, and it was for campaign reporting violations. That fine, however, was for the campaign not reporting 1,300 contributions within 48 hours, which is required by law, and for receiving some donations that went over the allowable limit, which is seen as an inadvertent civil violation punished by fines, not prison, which does not seem comparable to the allegations that a candidate directly ordered his lawyer to commit campaign violations, which would be a criminal violation. And in fact, those differences are most likely understood by the Trump campaign and the Trump administration because they had their own fine like the Obama administration had to deal with. They had to pay a fine a few weeks before the 2016 election for 1,100 donations that exceeded the allowable limit. It just simply appears to be a bogus comparison. And what's really interesting is Donald Trump's current defense. In an exclusive preview clip for an interview that they're releasing tomorrow morning, Fox and Friends have Donald Trump saying this.
"Did you know about the payments?"
Later on I knew, later on. But you have to understand, Ainsley, what he did, and they weren't taken out of campaign finance. That's a big thing. That's a much bigger thing. Did they come out of the campaign? They didn't come out of the campaign. They came from me, and I tweeted about it.
And I will say, personally, that sounds extremely confusing. He says that he learned about the payments later on, but claims the payments came from him. And so, one, the timeline of events doesn't really seem to make sense. And two, not that I guess it even matters anymore, but that completely contradicts what Donald Trump has said in the past regarding payments.
"Did you know about the $130,000 payment to Stormy Daniels?"
But when it comes to the point of legality, one, he technically wasn't under oath there. And two, most likely the big reason that they are trying to shift the narrative that it is now, the money came from me, yes, it did happen. That hits on something that Hans van Spakovsky has said. He's a former commissioner at the Federal Election Commission, and a note that he hit on is a candidate can spend as much of their own money as they want to, even if it was a campaign-related expense. Adding, yes, Cohen pleaded guilty to it, yeah, Cohen paid it, but then Cohen was reimbursed by Trump. But ultimately, that is where we are with this situation, and of course, this is not happening in a bubble, this is happening at the same time as Manafort being found guilty. And in the midst of all of this, we're seeing some Democrats trying to use this situation as a way to slow down or halt Kavanaugh's nomination. Senator Richard Blumenthal saying, "The Supreme Court will be forever stained and tainted if Brett Kavanaugh is confirmed after his nomination by a president that has been implicated in the most serious criminal wrongdoing affecting the outcome of his own election." But on that note, a spokesperson for Senator Chuck Grassley has said that September 4th is still set for Kavanaugh's hearing, and that's where we're going to leave that story. But with all of that said, I do want to pass the question off to you. What are your thoughts about this? And that's where I'm going to end today's Philip DeFranco show. And also remember, this is a conversation, so whether it be the last story, the first one, anything in between, let me know what you're thinking in those comments down below. Also, while you're at it, if you like this video, throw a like our way. If you're new here, hit that subscribe button, turn notifications on by ringing that bell. That way you don't miss these daily weekday Philip DeFranco shows or our morning test shows that we've been doing this week. But with all of that said, of course, as always, my name's Philip DeFranco. You've just been filled in. I love yo faces, and I'll see you tomorrow.